Begin our sacred liturgy in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. The Lord be with you. In today's readings, we will hear how love conquers all and how Jesus gives us a process of how to use that love for resolution conflict. And so, I don't want you to count, but I want you to, every time, you're going to hear the word love so many times. Now, don't be one of those parishioners that say after Mass, Father, it said 56 times the word love, because some people will count it for me and then not pay attention to the Mass. But listen to how many times you hear the word love in today's liturgy. But before we can enter into this liturgy, let us ask for God's mercy, for his pardon, for his peace, so that we may open ourselves up to connect to the sacred, to hear God's word, and to receive Jesus in the Eucharist. Let's call to mind our sins. Lord Jesus, you are in our midst, directing us towards your Father. Lord, have mercy. Christ Jesus, you have entrusted to us the good news of reconciliation. Christ, have mercy. Lord Jesus, you call us to live your command out of love. Lord, have mercy. May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life.
Glory to God in the highest, and on earth we bless you, we adore you, we glorify you, we give thanks for your great glory, Lord God, heavenly King.
Let us pray. O God, by whom we are redeemed and receive adoption, look graciously upon your beloved sons and daughters, that those who believe in Christ may receive true freedom, an everlasting inheritance, through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
A reading from the book of the prophet Ezekiel. Thus says the Lord, you, son of man, I have appointed watchmen for the house of Israel. When you hear me say anything, you shall warn them for me. If I tell the wicked, O wicked one, you shall surely die, and you do not speak out to dissuade the wicked from his way, the wicked shall die for his guilt. But I will hold you responsible for his death. But if you warn the wicked, trying to turn him from his way, and he refuses to turn from his way, he shall surely die for his guilt, but you shall save yourself. The word of the Lord.
A reading from the letter of St. Paul to the Romans. Brothers and sisters, owe nothing to anyone except to love one another. For the one who loves another has fulfilled the law. The commandments: you shall not commit adultery, you shall not kill, you shall not steal, you shall not covet, and whatever other commandments there may be, are summed up in this saying, namely, you shall love your neighbor as yourself. Love does no evil to the neighbor. Hence, love is the fulfillment of the law. The word of the Lord.
Gospel according to Matthew. Jesus said to his disciples, "If your brother sins against you, go and tell him his faults between you and him alone. If he listens to you, you have won over your brother. If he does not listen, take one or two others along with you, so that every fact may be established on the testimony of two or three witnesses. If he refuses to listen to them, tell the church. If he refuses to listen even to the church, then treat him as you would a Gentile or a tax collector. Amen, I say to you, whatever you bind on earth shall be bound in heaven, and whatever you loose on earth shall be loosed in heaven. Again, amen, I say to you, if two of you agree on earth about anything for which they are to pray, it shall be granted to them by my heavenly Father. For where two or three are gathered together in my name, there am I in the midst of them." The Gospel of the Lord.
What is it about the church and family that can create such warm and nourishing communities while at the same time can foster destruction, even hateful conflict, and even division within families and the church? Such is the challenge facing many churches and many families today. And today's gospel reading from Matthew and Paul's letter to the Romans give us encouragement. It is helpful and comforting to remember that most of the New Testament was written in the midst of conflict, in the midst of persecution. From the beginning of our church, there has always been difficulties, either from the Roman government or religious establishments of the time. The first century church also knew internal conflict. There's always conflict within the church. And it is interesting to note that all of Paul's letters reveal some level of church problems. Congregations in Corinth, Thessalonica, Philippi, Galatia all struggled to be the people of God in the midst of difficult times, in the midst of them being killed, being martyred, in the midst of conflict. Now, more than ever, we need to be transparent. We need to be real with each other. And the grace of God does not remove the misunderstandings and struggles from our human family. Now get this. Instead, God's grace gives us strength to name the struggle and the wisdom to respond out of love. Very good. Way to go. You always give the good answers up here, Coach. Very good. So what does Sacred Scripture tell us about dealing with difficult people, difficult situations, with conflict? Now, first, we need to remember that all of us can be difficult. Amen? Don't be looking at each other. We all can be difficult. Me too. I can be difficult. All of us, in one way or another, we have a strong-willed side to us. No matter how quiet we may seem, no matter how timid we may seem, we all have a strong-willed side to us, insisting sometimes on our own way, at times not recognizing or trying to understand the views or even the hopes of the other. Didn't St. Francis say, seek to understand rather than to be understood? Now, in today's gospel reading, we heard from Matthew, Jesus gives directions to his people for dealing with conflict. He speaks of the situation, not uncommon in our day, where someone sins against you or against me. Meaning what? Meaning they have wounded us. They have hurt you or treated you unjustly. What Jesus does is give us a process for facing the hurt others have done to us, using simple, however often difficult, directness. Now, this is what Jesus says. If someone hurts you, go and tell them privately. If that fails, take one or two people with you. If that fails, ask the church to help you do the hard work of reconciliation. Sounds hard, and it is hard. Some people will do whatever they can to avoid conflict. However, in a profound level, conflict brings us closer together if it is done out of love. At profound level, all of us, we all can be difficult. Amen? Don't pinch the other person. We all can be difficult. That said, the work of speaking the truth to another, even though it is hard to say and even harder to hear, offers the best way for restored relationships. No one can prepare for, much less have, such a conversation without first remembering that every one of us can be a difficult person. People, our greatest need is to be loved, is to be valued. Our greatest need is to be respected, to be accepted, and to have another who wants a broken relationship to be restored is a blessing, an opportunity to grow in knowledge of the other person, and an opportunity for ourselves to be better people. Such restoration begins when we speak the truth in love. Paul's instructions to the Romans in our second reading was simple, however very strong. Owe no one anything except to love one another. And there's that crazy word again, love. Why? Because love does no wrong to a neighbor. Love never does wrong. If our motivation is out of love, it never does wrong. The question remains, how do you pull this off? And it's important to know that when someone hurts us, we quickly make a judgment and believe that they hurt us on purpose without thinking that maybe they reacted to a misunderstood hurt we may have caused them. People, I truly believe we don't stay up late at night trying to figure out, how can I hurt my husband? I want to hurt him bad. Or how can I hurt my wife? Or how can I hurt my children? Or even the children thinking, how can I hurt my parents? Well, maybe the children, but that's a whole other issue. That's a whole other issue. So let's think of this. What would happen if we would first believe that the other person unknowingly wounded us? If that would be the premise we approach them, that they unknowingly wounded us. What if we deeply believe our hurt was a random mistake? If we would believe that, it would be much easier to speak the truth in love by saying, I know you never meant to offend me. However, what you did or what you said, it really hurt me. Could we talk about this? Such an opening might create a place where healing could mend wounded hearts. Kind of sounds like that Bee Gees song, huh? I saw a documentary the other day on the Bee Gees. Do y'all know the song, How Do You Mend a Broken Heart? Okay, that you don't get kudos or anything like that. That's good to know. However, where we have the promise of hope and healing is through Jesus Christ. It's through Jesus Christ. Would you believe me, or I ask you to believe with me, that the one compelling reason we honor, worship, adore, and serve our God is because God tells us the truth about ourselves while still loving us unconditionally? Isn't that awesome? He tells the truth about ourselves to face our ugliness, yet at the same time, He loves us unconditionally. God not only names our sins, however, He knows us to be sinners. God's unconditional love draws us to His heart of love, where with infinite patience and infinite honesty, God speaks truth. And the thing is, God already knows your sins. He knows my sins. But what He wants from us is to be able to let go and not make excuses or not to blame other people, to let go and to tell God our sins so that we can know our sins, so that we can receive the graces and the sacrament of reconciliation, to let go of our selfishness, to let go of our sins, because all God wants to do is to love us even more. And all we need to do is to let go and to allow Him to love us even more, for us not to be our own worst enemy. And as difficult as as all of this can be, God never gives up on us. He never gives up on us. God pursues us with His mercy. God pursues us to forgive us with grace and restore us with love. This is also what we are called to do in relationship with one another. Never to give up. To speak the truth in love. To remember that Christian honesty spoken with true love has within it the power to recreate and sustain Christian communities, sustain Christian families and relationships. Let us never give up on each other. Let us never give up on love, knowing that God never gives up on us. I'd like to take the time right now. If I have offended any of you in any way, if I have said anything to you that may have hurt you, I am truly sorry, because that's not my heart. I too make mistakes, and I too get angry, and I too want to slap people. Not you guys, of course, not you guys. However, there comes a time where we just have to say, I didn't mean it. I acted out of insecurity, or I acted out of anger, or maybe you hooked me in some way of a past emotion and brought it forward. So if I've offended any of you, I'm sorry. But people, you may or may not know this. However, because of our hurt, because of our pain or anxiety and frustrations during these months we are living in, because of wanting to be loved more, because of wanting to be valued, because of wanting to be accepted, we are living these last 6 months in situations that brings up many conflicts with relationship between spouses, in the family, with friends, and in the church. Think of it. Emotionally and spiritually, it would take years to nurture a healthy relationship, to get to know and sustain a relationship with another through a natural course of time. However, this natural course of time has been interrupted these past 6 months, which causes conflict, which causes maybe for some of us many arguments, many misunderstandings within any relationship. And so let's be patient with each other. Because a lot of times we are acting out of isolation. We respond out of fear, out of loneliness, not feeling loved. And so I ask you to look honestly at yourself. And I'm going to look honestly at myself too. And I'm going to ask you questions, and I don't want you to raise your hand. Oh, that's me, that's me. It's not group confession time. But look honestly at yourself. Do you ever feel that you are not loved, not respected? Do you ever feel like you want to escape and just go anywhere to get away from it all? Do you ever feel not wanted, or that maybe you're in the way? Do you have a longing, a need for connection, a need for meaning and purpose out of all of this stuff that's going on? People, this is the heart and soul of a person crying out to be unconditionally loved, to be unconditionally valued, to be unconditionally accepted. And the only one that can completely fill these needs is only Jesus Christ. Only Jesus Christ. But the sad thing is, we want our husbands to feel those needs. We want our wives to feel those needs. We want our parents, our children, we want our relationship to feel those needs. And it's not fair to them, because it is only God that can fill those needs. We can't put our husbands and our wives on the pedestal and expect them to fill that emptiness sometimes we feel in our souls, because they cannot do it. We're setting them up for failure. And then we blame them, and we argue with them. We have conflict with them. Honey, if you really loved me, you would be able to read my mind by now. We've been married for 6 months. You should know me completely. No, that's not fair. It's not fair to them, and it's not fair to you, and it's not fair to family. Remember that Barry White song? I'm not going to sing it, because he has his real deep voice. But that Barry White song that says, "You're my first, you're my last, you're my achihuahuas." Go 70s, all right. "You're my first, you're my last, you're my everything." No creo yo. No. Christ is the Alpha and the Omega. Christ is our everything. St. Augustine once said, "Our heart is restless until it rests in you." That longing lives in us until we find communion, until we find a true relationship with God and experience His love, His forgiveness, His mercy. And once we experience that from God, and we sustain that relationship with Jesus Christ, then we can share that with our husbands and share that with our wives and share it with our children, with our parents. Because we cannot give something that we do not have. It's only in God that our restless hearts can find rest. And because of these challenging months, people, we must hold on to faith. We must hold on to unconditional love. We need to hold on to purpose and hope, and then we share this with those who we love in life rather than demand it from them or expect them to be your everything. Only God. Now, September 11th, we're going to have a remembering the tragedy of over 3,000 people dying. But people, after that tragedy, our country gathered together. We became stronger because of that conflict. And we can't forget. People, out of what we're going through now, the past 6-7 months, and how long it's going to go forward through it, we are going to become stronger. And we have to believe this. We have to hope this, because this is the foundation of who we are. People, at this very moment, at this very time, our country, us Christians, we are evolving, and I hope you understand this. We're evolving in the midst of conflict, just like the early church, in the midst of persecution, just like the early church, in the midst of violence, in the midst of hatred, in the midst of division, just like the early church. Love conquers all. And yes, we're separated because of this virus. We're separated and have to watch mass online. We're separated having to be 6 feet apart. We're separated with certain rules and guidelines. But this separation has us longing to have a culture of belonging. And I think that's going to be the outcome of all of this. I pray it's going to be the outcome of all this. Our culture is going to change into a culture of belonging, of wanting to be connected, of wanting to be accepted, of wanting to be a part. And let me tell you, people, the body of Christ, the church, is going to be the center of love, of hope, of healing, and the promise of giving that mercy of God that brings us all together, because we all belong to the church. Amen. We all are the body of Christ. Amen. And there's nothing, nothing that can separate us from the love of God. This is our faith. This is what we believe in. This is the gift that's going to come out of all of this. And we are going to become stronger. And we got to believe that. And we're going to seek to belong, to be a part, to be a culture of belonging. Such is the gift that the church has to offer. Such is the gift that Jesus, God, the Holy Spirit, dwelling in us, wants us to live out. And so, people, you who are in despair, in conflict, who are in worry, discouragement, hold on for the ride. Because there's going to be a great miracle that you and I are going to be a part of if our foundation is based on love. Amen. So let us stand and profess our faith. And so, church, I ask you not to say what you believe in, but what do you live out? I believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. I believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages,
God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, consubstantial with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us men and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the Holy Spirit was incarnate of the Virgin Mary and became man. For our sake, who was crucified under Pontius Pilate, he suffered death and was buried, and rose again on the third day in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven, and it is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is adored and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. I believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. I confess one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. And I look forward to the resurrection of the dead and life of the world to come. Drawn together as a church of belonging, we have the faith to turn to our Lord and to place our trust in him.
That the church will actively seek reconciliation and work collaboratively. In your mercy, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayers.
That those who suffer and grieve as a result of violence will be strengthened and supported by caring communities. In your mercy, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayers.
That we who are gathered will live unselfishly, carrying out God's commandment of love. In your mercy, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayers.
That voters will listen to the Holy Spirit as they prepare to vote in the forthcoming elections. In your mercy, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayers.
That those who are sick and suffering from the coronavirus will be lifted up with Christ in their suffering. In your mercy, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayers.
That those who have died will be bound to Christ in eternal glory, including Larry and Wanda O'Leary. In your mercy, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayers.
That we may allow stewardship to blossom in our hearts and joyfully share our gifts to our 90-day infusion program of hope and healing. In your mercy, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayers.
And at this time, I invite all of us to lift up in prayer any person that we may have hurt, either intentionally or unintentionally. Let us lift them up in prayer and only hope for the best for them. In your mercy, we pray to the Lord. God of love, where two or more are gathered in your name, you are in their midst. Hear the prayers of your faithful gathered here, for they are people who strive towards holiness and who depend on your love, so that we may be a people of belonging, the body of Christ. We ask this through Christ our Lord. You may be seated for the offertory.
Love one another as I have loved you. Bear with each other and always be true. Other
bless you, Lord God of all creation. For through your goodness we have received the bread we offer you, fruit of the earth and work of human hands, it will become for us the bread of life. And blessed are you, Lord God of all creation. For through your goodness we have received the wine we offer you, fruit of the vine and work of human hands, it will become for us our spiritual drink.
Love one another as I have loved you. Bear with each other and always be true. Live for each other in unity and strength. Give to each other.
Pray, dear friends, that my sacrifice and yours here on this holy altar may be acceptable to God, our Almighty Father. O God, give us the gift of true prayer and of peace. Graciously grant that through this offering we may do fitting homage to your divine majesty, and by partaking of the sacred mystery, we may be faithfully united in mind and heart through Christ our Lord. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly right and just. It's our duty and our salvation always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty, Eternal God, through Christ our Lord. His death we celebrate in love. His resurrection we confess with living faith. And his coming again in glory we await with unwavering hope. And so with the angels and saints we praise you, as without end we acclaim. Almighty Father, we bless through Jesus Christ, your Son, who comes in your name. He himself is the word that brings salvation, the hand you extend to sinners, the way by which your peace is offered to us. When we ourselves have turned away from you on account of our sins, you brought us back to be reconciled, O Lord, so that converted at last to you, we might love one another through your Son, whom for our sake you were handed over to death. And now, celebrating the reconciliation Christ has brought us, we entreat you to sanctify these gifts by the outpouring of your Spirit, that they may become the body and blood of your Son, whose command we fulfill when we celebrate these mysteries. For when about to give his life to set us free, as he reclined at supper, he himself took bread into his hands and, giving you thanks, said the blessings, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way,
on that same evening, he took the chalice of blessing in his hands, confessing your mercy, and gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me.
The mystery of faith.
We proclaim your death, O Lord, and profess your resurrection until you come again, until you come again.
Celebrating, therefore, the memorial of the death and resurrection of your Son, who left us this pledge of his love, we offer you what you have bestowed on us, the sacrifice of perfect reconciliation. Holy Father, we humbly beseech you to accept us together with your Son, and in this saving banquet, graciously to endow us with his very Spirit, who takes away everything that estranges us from one another. May he make your church a sign of unity and an instrument of your peace among all people. And may he keep us always in communion with Pope Francis, with our Bishop Michael, with all the bishops and your entire people. Just as you have gathered us now at the table of your Son, so also bring us together with the glorious Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with your blessed angels and all the saints, Saint Joseph, her spouse, with our brothers and sisters, and those of every race and tongue who have died in your friendship. Bring us to share with them the unending banquet of unity in a new heaven and a new earth, where the fullness of your peace will always shine forth in Christ Jesus our Lord. Through him, with him, in him, O God Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever. At the Savior's command and formed by divine teaching, we dare to pray, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil, and graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ. Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, peace I leave you, my peace I give you. Look not on our sins, but look on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reigns forever and ever. The peace of the Lord be with you always.
Let us offer each other the sign of peace.
Thank you.
Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. The body and blood of Christ one day bring you and me to everlasting life. For those of us, those who are sharing this Mass with us online, let us pray together the act of spiritual communion together at home. My Jesus, I believe that you are in the Blessed Sacrament. I love you above all things, and I long for you in my soul. Since I cannot now receive you sacramentally, come at least spiritually into my heart as though you have already come. I embrace you and unite myself entirely to you. Never permit me to be separated from you. Amen.
Be forgiveness in me, heal us. We come to you, we come to thank you. darkness tries to roll over my bones, when sorrow comes to steal the joy I own, when brokenness and pain is all I know, I won't be shaken, I won't be shaken. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love.
Let us pray. Grant that your faithful, O Lord, whom you nourish and endow with life through the food of your word and heavenly sacrament, may so benefit from your beloved Son's great gifts that we may merit an eternal share in his life, who lives and reigns forever and ever. You may be seated just for a few moments. There are two letters that I've written especially for you, so please take time to read the letters that are in the bulletin. And also the Hope and Healing thank you letters have been mailed out this last Friday. And so from the bottom of our hearts, who have been blessed by those who have taken part in the 90-day infusion program of Hope and Healing, we thank you. And there may be some who haven't had the opportunity to participate. We do have in back of the church those who still want to participate. And again, it could be $5 to whatever, even $3. It's the whole idea of participating. In back of the church, there is a letter and there are envelopes in back of the church if you'd like to participate in this program. And also, OPH and OPH Academies are having a drive-through barbecue fundraiser on Saturday, October 3rd, from 11 to 4 p.m. The barbecue plates will cost $8 each, and they may be purchased at the academy office or the parish office. Do we have anyone selling the tickets? So there will be someone, I think it's Sarah and some others, who will be selling the barbecue tickets in back of the church. We will sell the tickets and only cook the amount of orders that we get. So please support the school and the church when it comes to the barbecue tickets. Also, our OPH prayer yard signs are available in the parish office. We've passed out over 2,000 prayer yard signs. You can come to the office. The donation is $5. We're not receiving any money from giving these prayer signs out. The Life Teen School, Youth Group, and Edge Middle School will have a drive-through registration September 9th. Those who are in middle school and in high school, it'll be September 9th from 5 to 7 p.m. in front of the parish office area. We are going to have ways of having online and also in person, and we will follow the mandates, but we do ask all high school and middle school to be involved. Your help is greatly appreciated for those who can help disinfect the church immediately after Mass. And also Monday, Labor Day, the parish offices are closed. There's a lot of more important information in today's bulletin. And also the video that of today's Mass will have on replay on Facebook in 15 minutes and also can be seen on YouTube and our OLPH CCTX channel, or visit our parish website and click on Mass Archives. If you are from another parish and you're watching this Mass online, it is always good to support your own home parish. And I'm sure your pastor would appreciate you giving your tithing, your offertories to your parish, no matter where you may be. And at this time, we would like to remember.
The world was different that day. The economy was booming, 401ks were solid, and if asked, 8 out of 10 Americans wouldn't be able to define the word jihad. On that day, something happened that changed everything. That day was a Tuesday. For most of us, our only connection to the events of that day was what we saw on television. However, we are all connected and that we all have a place. For some of us, it's a spot on the highway. For others, it's in an office. Or at coffee with a friend. It's the place we will never forget. The place where we watched it happen on that day. So here we are, many days later, still hurt, still angry, still trying to understand why. 1 Corinthians 13 explains that we don't see things clearly right now. In essence, we just won't be able to understand in this lifetime things like what happened on that day. However, it goes on to say that one day we will see all things clearly. But until that day comes, we have three things to embrace to help us in our reconciliation: faith in God, unswerving hope, and love. And the greatest of the three is love. Through the shock and the horror, something else happened on that day. Although the evil intentions appeared to be a success, our country embraced the complete opposite of what was intended. Instead of division, there was unity. Instead of confusion, there was clarity. And instead of falling apart, we banded together. But then again, that's the way one nation under God will always respond.
The Lord be with you. May the blessings of Almighty God be upon each and every one of us, and also those that we love. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Go in peace, glorifying God with our lives.
Thanks be to God. And people, make it a wonderful week this week. Promise? What happens if you don't? You burn. Very good. God bless you.